They only survive now in smaller copies, but it's enough to give you a vivid impression of what was once planned. The impulsive Leonardo, fascinated by turbulent motion, went for a great scene of battle. Michelangelo planned to create an elegant set of studies of the male nude, a multitude of soldiers surprised by the enemy while bathing in a river. In the end, neither man ever completed their work. Vasari tells us that Michelangelo's sketch was so venerated that Florence's artists cut it up into pieces and divided the fragments between them. Leonardo's unfinished painting was supposedly left in place. The frescoes should have hung here, in the room of the 500, in the Palazzo Vecchio, the seat of Florentine government. But more than 40 years after Leonardo's death, the Medici commissioned none other than Giorgio Vasari himself to create a new series of muscular battle paintings.
Cominciamo di parlare di Leonardo contro Michelangelo in questa sala. Possimi dire un po'?
Più che contro era uno, più che uno scontro fra due grandi. Era una grande città consapevole di avere due artisti sublimi. Nasce proprio a Firenze perché se noi riusciamo ad immaginarci in questo salone questi due affreschi monumentali, che dovevano esserci, poi non è andata bene, ma dovevano esserci questi due affreschi monumentali di Michelangelo con la battaglia di Cascina e di Leonardo con la battaglia di Anghiari, con le dimensioni che avevano, 15-16 metri, non ricordo di preciso, metri, per 5-6.
Ma è possibile che dentro questi affreschi è possibile che rimane un po' di...
Io ho sempre pensato, e credo che gli esperimenti tentati siano esperimenti con macchine oppure con sistemi, come si può dire, endoscopici, cioè con delle telecamere che entrano, indagano, vedono per quello che si può vedere. Perché se anche si trovasse un solo dito di una mano, sarebbe comunque un ritrovamento importante, perché sarebbe l'attestato di un fatto realmente accaduto.
E che facciamo? Se c'è qualcosa veramente grande dentro, che possiamo fare?
Credo niente. Non è ammissibile distruggere gli affreschi di Vasari.
Vasari was a very different artist from either Leonardo or Michelangelo. More subservient to his Medici patrons, but innovative in his own way. He could almost be described as a kind of Andy Warhol of his time, because he was a pioneer of studio mass production, employing a factory of apprentices to help him carry out his major commissions. The results were admittedly uneven, but if he had painted everything by hand, Vasari could never have achieved all that he did in his lifetime.
He was a compulsive overachiever, at the same time as covering Cosimo I's Sala del Cinquecento with images of Medici might, fascistic images of triumph, of thumping military victory. He was revising his monumental Lives of the Artists. He just designed the Uffizi Gallery. He was constructing a corridor to connect the Uffizi Gallery and the Palazzo Vecchio to the Pitti Palace, the Medici's new residence. Here was a man manically overachieving. It's as if Vasari had an absolute horror of inactivity.
The second of Vasari's golden age geniuses was Raffaello Sanzio, or Raphael. Whereas Leonardo was older than the great Michelangelo, Raphael was 8 years his junior. He died tragically young in 1537, although he left behind him a formidable body of work. He was regarded as such a prodigy that by the age of just 23, he'd been called to Rome to work as one of the principal painters to Pope Julius II. It was for Julius that he created many of his greatest masterpieces, including the monumental School of Athens, a depiction of the progress of human knowledge, which he imagines being passed from person to person, from Plato and Aristotle on to the present day. To one side of the scene, Raphael included his own self-portrait, looking out at us with a self-possessed expression on his young face. He even took time to have a sly dig at his rival Michelangelo, painting him as a rather miserable-looking hermit. The two artists clashed frequently and were deeply suspicious of each other, so it's not surprising that Vasari, Michelangelo's great disciple, should have subtly criticized Raphael, emphasizing his worldliness, even his decadence, especially when describing his work for one of Rome's leading money men.
This is our Renaissance lifestyles of the rich and famous moment, because this is the Villa Farnesina, once the palace of Agostino Chigi, the richest man in all of Renaissance Rome. He was the Pope's banker. And what he represents is a particular moment when a rather decadent elite begins to discover in art and in the mythology of the classical world all kinds of rather interestingly erotic possibilities. He's had no less an artist than Raphael paint for him this wonderful picture of the sexy sea nymph Galatea running away, half running away, half turning to greet perhaps her pursuer. I think what Raphael's really painted for his patron in this image of nudity with the wonderful three cupids above firing their darts of love at the nymph is a tremendously assured piece of mythological soft porn. But if you thought that was risque, it's really only the aperitif for a veritable banquet of erotica. And here it is, the Loggia of Cupid and Psyche, a wonderful panorama of the sexual goings on, the ins and outs of the gods of the classical past. Up there we've got the Marriage of Cupid and Psyche, up there we've got the Council of Gods, and all around we've got naked gods and goddesses disporting themselves. And Vasari tells us that when Raphael and his school were painting these wonderfully sexy pictures, Raphael got so excited that he was unable to paint. And so Chigi, driven to distraction by this absentee artist who kept going off into the center of town to visit his girlfriend, thought, well, the only way I can get him to finish these pictures is if I bring his girlfriend here. His girlfriend being a lady called La Fornarina, the baker's daughter. And so Vasari tells us that Chigi got La Fornarina, persuaded her at great expense to actually live in the palace. She made love to Raphael every morning and every evening, and he painted happily in between. Now, I know the whole story might be